Welcome to today's spinal cord injury training entitled A Collaboration Between Kessler Foundation, Kessler Institute for Rehabilitation, and the New Jersey Division of Vocational Rehabilitation. My name is John Takaz. I'm the Program Planning and Development Specialist and Certified Rehabilitation Counselor. I'm a contract manager over the statewide Assisted Technology Advocacy Center and Spinal Cord Injury Innovation and Expansion, Work First Contract, and Pre-Ed's Employment Training Paid Internship Contracts. I am a program manager over the following areas: Substance Use Disorder, Mental Health, and Brain Injury Programs. I'm responsible for onboarding new vendors for neuropsychologists, psychologists, and assisted technology vendors. I hold the role of DVR's liaison for the State Rehabilitation Counselor for the Commission for the Blind and Vision Impaired, as well as the State Behavioral Health Planning Council and the Veterans Administration liaison. Let me give you a little background of this contract. This Innovation and Expansion Grant was awarded to Kessler and addresses an important demonstrated gap in the service and a critical area of need for individuals with spinal cord injury attaining employment after a spinal cord injury. Attaining employment is an important achievement for individuals with spinal cord injury, as it leads to increased independence and social integration, greater life satisfaction, and improved quality of life. However, rates of return to work following spinal cord injury remain low, with unemployment rates in the spinal cord injury population reported in excess of tenfold compared with the general population. The counties served under this contract are Bergen, Essex, Hudson, Hunterdon, Middlesex, Morris, Passaic, Somerset, Sussex, Union, and Warren. Recently added are Ocean and Monmouth. This grant funds the staff position entitled Vocational Resource Facilitator held by Adria DeSimone. The following are the deliverables of the contract. The Vocational Resource Facilitator will follow up with approximately 85 spinal cord injury participants. They will provide individual vocational rehabilitation counseling supports for 31 new inpatient spinal cord injury participants with goals to return to work in a previous position or to pursue a new career goal or pursue higher education or retraining. It's a collaborative effort with the local DVRS counselor in coordination with services of Kessler. Present options for intensive early intervention services such as assisted technology or adaptive equipment to 21 individuals who continue to perform same work as inpatient, or to ensure smooth return to work experience for outpatients who return to pre-injury work, same job, or to a reassignment during outpatient rehabilitation. Assist 11 employers as needed with resource information to assess or trial assistive technology or other functional modifications to reduce obstacles to employees with spinal cord injury in the workplace. Continue to provide services related to medical management, community reintegration, and employability, and to refer 18 participants to New Jersey DVRS and assist counselors with shared case coordination responsibilities to identify services that contribute to employment outcomes. The vocational resource facilitator will track and report the return to work capacities on a quarterly basis for individuals entering gainful employment to include same job, same employer, different job, same employer, and new job, new employer. Also on a quarterly basis, they will track, report, assist each participant with goals to return to school or pursue certification, retraining that will lead to competitive employment. And lastly, the Kessler Foundation will provide two virtually professional development trainings to DVR staff. Today's agenda includes an overview of the Kessler system with Dr. Stephen Kirschblum and Dr. Trevor Dyson Hudson. They will provide history and the relationship between Kessler Institute and Kessler Foundation, the populations and services, and the Model System Center. Then we'll have an introduction to spinal cord injury with Dr. Trevor Dyson Hudson and Dr. Kirschblum. Next, Dr. John O'Neill will talk about resource facilitation, providing history and background, application to spinal cord injury. And then the vocational resource facilitator, Adria DeSimone, will provide an overview of vocational resource facilitation role, early intervention vocational services, 2-year follow-along process, and project data outcomes, and then we will share case stories, closing with question and answers. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank my coworker, Tanya Ansango, for her assistance with the Zoom and her technical assistance, and to acknowledge my chief of the program unit, Marianne Teasler, and our communication access real-time part person, Randy Friedman. Now, a little background on our speakers. Dr. Trevor Dyson Hudson is our medical director and director of the Centers for Spinal Cord Injury Research and Outcomes in Assessment Research, and co-director of the Defner-Lieberman Laboratory for Regenerative Rehabilitation Research at Kessler Foundation in West Orange. He is a research associate professor at Rutgers, New Jersey School in Newark. Dr. Dyson Hudson is co-director of the North New Jersey Spinal Cord Injury System at Kessler. As a person with lived experience of spinal cord injury, Dr. Dyson Hudson has served as a consumer representative on a number of organizational and government advisory committees, including the United Nations Department of Safety and Security. Dr. Stephen Kirschblum is medical director and is the chief medical officer of Kessler Institute for Rehabilitation and Kessler Foundation. Dr. Kirschblum is nationally recognized expert in spinal cord injury rehabilitation and research, who also co-directs the Foundation's Reynolds Center for Spinal Stimulation and the Centers for Spinal Cord Injury Research and Outcomes and Assessment Research. He is a professor at Rutgers, New Jersey Medical School, where he chairs the Department of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation and is program director for the Spinal Cord Injury Medicine Fellowship Program. Dr. John O'Neill is a PhD and is a director of the Center for Employment and Disability Research at the Kessler Foundation. Dr. O'Neill is a national expert in disability employment with more than 35 years of experience in vocational rehabilitation research. Dr. O'Neill is on the New York Rehabilitation Council and is the faculty of Hunterdon College of the City University of New York, Rutgers, New Jersey Medical School's Department of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation, and the John J. Heldrick Center for Workforce Development at Rutgers University. He is co-editor of National Trends in Disability Employment, a monthly report supported by National Institute on Disability, Independent Living, and Rehabilitation Research, which is issued by Kessler Foundation and the University of New Hampshire. Adrienne DeSimone is our full-time vocational resource facilitator for the contract, and she is nationally recognized certified rehabilitation counselor and a community partner work incentive counselor and licensed professional counselor. New to our staff is Laura Webb, who joined in April of 2021 and is a recent graduate from Rutgers. She's our part-time vocational resource facilitator. At this time, I'll turn the program over to our doctors.
Can they see?
Yes.
Can you see that, Tanya?
Yes.
Okay. What wonderful, wonderful. Well, thank you, John, for the introductions, and thank you, everyone, for joining us today. Dr. Kirschbaum, would you like to start?
Yes, thank you very much. I would like to take a moment just to thank John, who's just been a tremendous advocate for everyone and all the projects and programs that we've been doing. So John, thank you very much from all of us. If I could just ask if everyone can mute their lines, that may be helpful. Okay. I will move somewhat fast during these opening slides. Thank you. So Kessler Institute, let me start with just an introduction to that. It's named after Henry Kessler. And it's not just because it's named after him, because he did some good. He started this idea of having a rehabilitation center in New Jersey. He also is one of the pioneers of the field of physical medicine rehabilitation. He's an orthopedist by trade who wrote a book called The Knife Is Not Enough. He wanted to know what more he can do for people after he operated on them, and started to look at physical disabilities and want to know what is their life going to be like and how can he help them improve their quality of life as well as their medical activities. So he bought the hill that we are on, and this house, and he made this into a 16-bed rehabilitation hospital that has grown tremendously over the last 71 years. Next slide. Currently, Kessler Institute for Rehabilitation is four main campuses. At the West Orange facility is 152 beds. We have other campuses, including in Saddlebrook, which is in Bergen County, Chester campus, which is in Morris County, and the Malton campus, which is in South Jersey. You can see that we have a tremendous now amount of beds. So there's a lot, next slide. There's a lot of advertisement we can do regarding Kessler. I think the one thing that I really want to highlight is that we try to be a center that caters to people with all types of disabilities. We focus on spinal cord injury and brain injury, as well as amputee and stroke. And I think that we have merged our clinical care, which I believe is state of the art and is recognized as that, with our research and programs to help people as much as possible. Next slide. These are all the different types of programs that we focus on. And I believe that many of you are very familiar with the work that rehabilitation overall does. Next slide. Our approach is that we try to give specialty care. And specialty care means having people that are board certified, double board certified, with tremendous amount of experience. And this is what this slide projects, the amount of depth that we have in the program, experience in physicians, in therapists, in nurses, and certainly in terms of the work that we do with vocational services as well. We're also one of the few places that have driver rehabilitation trainings and a dedicated wheelchair seating and positioning team. Next slide. Our continuum of care, so we just don't care for people within rehabilitation, but we believe in lifelong care. It's helping people not only acutely after they may have their deficits come on, but also for their entire life and being able to follow up with them. Also of key importance is not only is the patient affected after a significant injury, but their families, their community as well. And so we work very hard with people so that they will have peer support. People who have gone through the things that they have, not only for the patient, but for their families. And that's where caregiver support and education is critical. Next slide. So Kessler Institute and Kessler Foundation, if we had a 4-hour program, we still wouldn't finish the depth of this relationship. But I know that I don't want to see a frown on John's face, so I'll say it very quickly. Kessler Foundation owned Kessler Institute in the past and sold Kessler Institute off to raise funds to be able to do research and unique education and vocational grant funding as part of their organization. So Kessler Institute is owned by a separate company, but yet we work very closely together. We are really, as they say, merged at the hips. We combine the care with the research, with the programmatic, and it's not just research or care, but it's programs that we have that we hope will serve the people that need that help for us. Next slide. Dr. Dyson Hudson, to you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kirschbaum. As Dr. Kirschbaum said, I mean, this really is a collaborative program. I work for Kessler Foundation. So even though I'm a physician by background, I work for Kessler Foundation. We're located physically on the same site. And as Dr. Kirschbaum was saying, Kessler is this state-of-the-art clinical facility that also has a research component. And in our bloodline with Kessler Foundation, we were part of Kessler Institute. And so the patient, as far as our research is concerned, comes first, or the individual. Now, one of the programs that really epitomizes this is our spinal cord injury model system. And this is a collaborative project between Kessler Institute, Kessler Foundation, and University Hospital in Newark. And you may have heard John say, this is a model system of spinal cord injury care. And so, you know, what do I mean by this model system? Okay, well, for right now, spinal cord injury is a condition for life. There unfortunately is no cure for spinal cord injury, but you know, through a model system program, it's a kind of a team cooperative effort. And it's a program of care for people with traumatic injury from time of injury all the way through long-term follow-up. So Dr. Kirschbaum mentioned that continuum of care. So, you know, when you think of the three facilities, you have University Hospital. So when somebody has a spinal cord injury, an ambulance, EMS is taking them to a level one trauma center where they're being evaluated by neurosurgeons who are experts in the field of spinal cord injury, who are providing surgery if it's warranted. And then as soon as those people are medically stable, they're being transferred to Kessler Institute, where they start to receive inpatient therapy. And that inpatient therapy, the goal is to get those people back home and back into the community. And then transitions to outpatient therapy. You know, all this time, we're able to do innovative type research projects. And these projects are to enhance health and quality of life. I mean, that's really ultimately the goal. And the other goal is to understand the long-term outcomes of spinal cord injury. We have a large database that's across the country that helps us determine and decide and follow what happens to people with spinal cord injury over time. And then what we learn, we share with people with spinal cord injury, their families, friends, as well as other professionals and researchers in this field. So as John T. mentioned in the introduction, there are 14 centers across the country. The yellow dots, so this is a competitive application. And these are the new centers for 2021 to 2026. There are 14 in all. The yellow ones represent ones that have been model systems in the past and are funded for this cycle. The blue ones represent new centers for this cycle, and the dark red circles are ones that had been model systems last cycle, but were not funded. So this is a competitive application, just to make you aware. And it just shows their distribution across the country. But each of these centers are doing the same thing we are at Kessler, you know, following people with spinal cord injury from time and injury all the way through, collecting data and doing research. So when we talk about traumatic spinal cord injury, this is what it is. One day you're going about your life and then you have an accident. And suddenly your whole life is turned upside down in a matter of seconds. So currently we know from the model systems, there's about 18,000 spinal cord injuries per year. It's a relatively small population, but it's a very expensive injury if you think about the long-term consequences in terms of the care over the span of the individual's life. We do know from the model systems that people with spinal cord injury have near normal life expectancies. So it's not a death sentence. It's all about getting that individual back up and into the community. So overall, over the years, there's about 300,000 people living with traumatic spinal cord injury. I'm going to go into kind of a distinction between traumatic and non-traumatic shortly, but the traumatic spinal cord injury happens in a relatively young population, predominantly men. And the reason is because we're risk takers, right? So generally it's a younger population, although the age has been increasing over recently. And that's because the population in the US is aging. We're all getting older, we live longer. Baby boomers are getting older. And as we get older, we get arthritic changes. You know, you feel it in your knees, you feel it in your shoulders, you get those same changes in your spine. And what happens is, let's say you slip in the bathroom, you fall down some stairs. And when you were younger, you were fine. But because of an arthritic change in your spine, when you got older, you now are a little more prone to having a spinal cord injury. So what we're seeing is kind of a blip. So there's a high prevalence in a younger population, and then there's also a higher prevalence in an older population. And those are the individuals who generally fall. As I said, this injury generally happens more commonly in men. And I always joke because, you know, I was a young, foolish man. You know, we're the risk takers. And that's how my injury happened, playing rugby, tackling somebody the wrong way. So this is a distribution of the causes of traumatic spinal cord injury. So the most common is motor vehicle crashes, followed by falls, and then acts of violence, you know, gunshot wounds, stabs, sports-related injuries, and then other categories. We're seeing an increase in the number of falls. And again, that's just because, you know, as the population ages, that's the group we're starting to see, you know, if somebody older falls, they're more prone to get a spinal cord injury. There was a time when violence was getting close to motor vehicle crashes, but thankfully that rate is down. And again, as I said, falls are most common in people in the older population. What we're seeing too is these tend to be neck injuries because the neck is relatively mobile. So you get something called high tetraplegia. And when you have a higher level injury, that can affect your diaphragm, which can affect your ability to breathe. And you may end up being on a vent if your injury is high enough. So I mentioned non-traumatic spinal cord injury. So traumatic is when there's an external cause. Non-traumatic is when there's something going on within the body. Most common causes are spinal stenosis and cancer of some type, and then as well as infections or other types of conditions, either nutritional conditions or infections or other things like that. But what you should remember is that spinal stenosis and spinal cord tumors are the most common causes of non-traumatic spinal cord injury. And I would say non-traumatic spinal cord injuries outnumber those of traumatic. So we may have 300 new admissions each year to Kessler. 100 of those will be traumatic spinal cord injury, and 200 or more could be non-traumatic spinal cord injury. So these are the classifications, and I'll explain these terms a little bit more as we go along, but tetraplegia is basically somebody who had a neck level injury. And then you'll hear this term complete, incomplete. Incomplete, the spinal cord is rarely severed as a result of an injury. There's usually some level of signal, the cord is still intact. And depending on how much signal is getting through, will define whether somebody is complete or incomplete. So you see a breakdown. So generally there's more people with tetraplegia, or the old term quadriplegia. Thankfully, there's more injuries that are incomplete, meaning there's some preserved function below the level of the injury. And then the rest are paraplegia, and that kind of breaks down. So you can see this is the distribution. So let's talk a little bit about tetraplegia versus paraplegia, right? And it really is based on the level of where the injury occurred. So if you think about tetraplegia or quadriplegia is the old term, it either happened higher up on the neck, in which we call that high tetraplegia. If it happens a little lower, it's low tetraplegia. And as you get lower, the more sensation and function you will have preserved. So, first, if you have a high level injury, you could have no function below the in your arms and no sensation. As your injury starts happening a little lower, you get more and more sensation and more function in your arms, into your hands. Once your injury is in the back, that's by definition paraplegia. And again, that's high paraplegia, low paraplegia. And as you work your way down the spine, you'll again get more function. So people who have paraplegia have full upper limb function, their hands function completely normally, and they start to get more function in their trunk and their abdomen as you get lower and lower. And as you get even lower, they may start to get muscle function in their hips and all the way down. As I mentioned, there's these terms complete versus incomplete. So complete, again, does not mean the spinal cord was severed. It just means there's no signal getting through from below the level of the injury up to the brain. No sensation and no motor function. If there is some signal getting through, you may have just sensation. And this is called sensory incomplete. And the more incomplete, so if you think about it, it makes sense. So the more preserved function, you start with sensation, you may then get motor, muscles. Those muscles may be functional or not functional. So if you have some muscle, but it's not all that function, then that's motor incomplete with a category of C. And these are very broad categories. And then as you get more and more function, so that over half of your muscles below the level of your injury are strong enough that they'll move against gravity, that's gets you a category of D. And what this means basically, as far as you're concerned, is somebody who has a C level type injury or C grade injury, they may have muscle function, but it's not functional, in the sense that they're not necessarily able to walk or stand. Somebody who has a grade of D may potentially be able to walk, whether it be in therapy with assistance or actually out into the community. Dr. Kirschbaum, would you like to talk about some of the complications associated with spinal cord injury?
Yes, absolutely. Well, no, I don't like talking about complications, but yeah. I think it really is important. And I'll try to be very focused for time's sake. So we're going to touch only on a few, but these are a few that really, if you see people with spinal cord injury, need to know how these really impact the people that you're going to see. So neurogenic bowel is the inability to control one's own bowels. It's an extremely important complication. It's extremely common. And you can see that not only is it a cause of rehospitalization for people, but this significantly impacts their quality of life. Oftentimes, after people have a spinal cord injury, the first things they think about is whether they'll be able to walk again. But as time goes on, people start to recognize that what's impacting their daily life is not that they're unable to walk, but it's the ability to control their bowels, their bladder, their pain that they may suffer. And that's why we're going to talk about these issues. And the most important thing about neurogenic bowel is that there are things we can do in the field of spinal cord injury to allow a person to have as much control of their bowels as possible, meaning that they're able to go to the bathroom at a set time, at a set place, without the fear of having accidents, which so impacts people in their fear of getting out into the public. Most especially going back to work, if they fear that they're going to have a bowel accident, that impacts their ability so much. And let me explain to you why. People may also have neurogenic bladder, which we'll talk about in a minute, but there are many ways to handle bladder. You can use indwelling catheters. You can have external catheters, indwelling catheters. You can even use a diaper. If someone has an accident, so with a diaper that no one will know. But with bowel accidents, you can't hide it because the smell would be so embarrassing. So the importance of getting neurogenic bowel fixed and helped is critically important. Next slide. Neurogenic bladder, I mentioned this is the inability now to control their bladder. It is the most common complication. And urinary tract infections, that's what UTI stands for, really impacts so many people. It is the most common reason for rehospitalization. It's interesting because the treatment of urinary tract infections today in 2021 is very different from what it was a decade ago, and certainly very different from what it was decades ago. Medicine, our ability, and people with spinal cord injury knowledge has really altered how we treat, when we treat people with spinal cord injury for their bladder. So that's why it's so important that the individuals with spinal cord injury follow up with people who are up to date with what to do. And this certainly is a lifelong endeavor handling this issue. Next slide. Neuropathic pain. I can tell you that neuropathic pain is something that impacts so many people. For just the ability, living with pain is so hard. And some people say, "Doc, it's so unfair. I can feel my legs, yet it's causing me such significant pain." And so the ability to try to treat these pains, and it's not just sharp pain, it's tingling pain, it's numbness pain. Think of someone's entire day going with their hitting their funny bone in their elbow or their leg falling asleep and how this possibly could impact them. And that's just some numbness and tingling. This is severe pain that impacts so many people. It causes distress. It causes them inability to get up or to want to get up, to get into their wheelchair and to do things, spend time with their family, their friends, their community activities, and certainly going back to work. And this is so important. You see at the bottom, 37% surveyed reported they would trade recovery of bowel, bladder, or sexual function for relief from pain. Because when you sense that you just can't get rid of it, that causes depression. And that causes the unwillingness or inability to move forward in their lives. Next slide. Spasticity. You know, we tackled the most common and perhaps some of the most debilitating for people with spinal cord injury. Spasticity is another one which is sometimes you'll see where the patient says that they feel extremely tight, their muscles are tight, or they have these wicked spasms that just they can't control. Almost 3/4 of people talk about how it impacts their quality of life. Almost half, it's a source of their depression, of their lacking independence. And I will tell you that spasticity and chronic pain go hand in hand. It could, the spasticity and pain impacts people's sleep, their ability to do things on a daily basis, even just getting out of bed. Now, on a positive side, many of these things can be tackled. They just have to get to the right place. And hopefully that if you have people with spinal cord injury, that that could be helped as well. Next slide. Dual diagnosis. This is a really tough one. And I'll explain to you why it's tough. Dr. Dyson Hudson showed that video that impacts me every time I see it. And what did he say about that? You saw about how that person hit their head, and we talked about the spinal cord injury. But think about it for a second. If an impact on your head is bad enough to be transmitted to the bones of your spinal cord to cause them to fracture and cause spinal cord injury, how can that happen without causing some brain injury as well? So often, up to 74% of the time, especially in cervical level injuries, people also have a concomitant traumatic brain injury. Thankfully, more often than not, it's minor, but it could also be moderate at the beginning as well. And we know that this is a complication. Next slide. But many people don't even recognize it for many reasons. First is many of the tests that we use are hand-based, or paper and pencil. Or computer-based, where they have to use a mouse. But people with spinal cord injury can't initially do that. There aren't good screening tests. People think that the CT or their MRI is ways to determine brain injury, but it's not. And then there's also this whole idea of you see the spinal cord, you see the devastating impact initially on the patient, the family. The last thing a family member, a patient wants to do, or a doctor wants to do is go to the family saying, by the way, not only do you have a spinal cord injury, but you have a brain injury. But as treating clinicians, and especially for you who may be seeing these patients, you have to understand, is there a brain injury as well? And if there is, what could be done to help them so that they can be successful in their vocational aptitudes and looking into what their future could be as well? Next slide. Rehabilitation. Rehabilitation is this whole idea of maximizing a patient's medical standpoint. And that's why we have spinal cord injury specialists. They're board certified in rehabilitation, but also board certified in spinal cord medicine. But it's maximizing physical capabilities, the ability to strengthen or find ways to improve their capability of walking or wheelchair mobility or transfers, family training, dealing with a patient's emotional reaction and their families, getting them back involved in their life, in their community, with their family, social activities, recreational activities, and most important also for this audience, vocational activities as well, because we all know how important work is to people. Next slide. Dr. Dyson Hudson, I think we're up to you.
Great, thank you, Dr. Kirschbaum.
I just want to say one thing. I may have to leave in a little while, but I do want to thank everyone for allowing us the opportunity to present to you. And I'm always available as needed to help anyone in the future.
Great. Thank you. So really in rehabilitation, what we try to focus on with people is not what you've lost, but what is it that you're dealing with, how we can try to address that, and what you have. And so, you know, I talked about some of the different levels of injury. And so what I wanted to review is just what people with different levels of injury are capable of doing based on what function they have. So somebody who has a very high level neck injury may not be able to move their arms. This is called high tetraplegia. They have no significant upper limb strength. They may be on a ventilator. They will require assistance with all their activities of daily living, most likely will require 24-hour assistance, and will need a power wheelchair for their mobility. But one of the themes I think you'll see throughout these slides is the role that assistive technology can play in making people with spinal cord injury independent. So here's a gentleman, I mean, most people, this is a very high profile person in the state of New Jersey. This is Eric Legrand. And he has a state-of-the-art wheelchair, and this makes him completely independent. Although he can't move his arms, through using a chin control, or others may have a sip and puff control, they're able to maneuver their wheelchair independently so they don't have to have somebody move them. They're also able to access features on that wheelchair so that they can tilt back in space to do pressure relief so they don't get pressure injuries, pressure sores, or they can relax leaning back. They can also access environmental controls, whether it be within the house or within an automobile. They can access their phones. They can do all these things independently. And you really don't appreciate not being able to do something until you can't do it. You know, having to have somebody move you, it's the independence you feel finally being able to move yourself independently. You can't put words to that. So this is for somebody with high tetraplegia. As you start to get lower, you start to gain some muscle function. So, you know, the first muscles that start to can play a role are your biceps, right? Because what this allows you to do is it allows you to bring your hands to your face. So people can start to do things for themselves. Your fingers may not function properly. So you'll need devices for your hands to be able to eat, but you can still bring your hand to your face and be able to feed yourself. And, again, another huge step in independence. You know, as a person with spinal cord injury, I at first couldn't move my arms. When I finally was able to move my arms and actually eat a potato chip on my own or hold the slice of pizza on my own, it just, the experience was so much different. It's really, you can't really describe, food just doesn't have the same feeling when somebody else is feeding it to you. Now, with somebody again with this C5 tetraplegia, they may require assistance for transfers because they don't have the upper body strength. However, you know, they're able to get around independently with a power wheelchair, and many can drive a modified van. You have enough arm strength, and there can be modifications that can be made to a vehicle that a person can now independently drive. And again, that just means a world for somebody to be able to get back out into the community. And again, I want to just kind of highlight some of these things, because these are things that you guys see in your offices, right? The wheelchair, driving, returning to driving, requests for modifications to vehicles, you know, all of these things. As one gets a slightly lower level injury, you're now able to have something called tenodesis. So this is a thing where if you raise your wrist, the fingers will come together. And what that does is that gives you kind of a crude pinch. And as I said, that'll allow you to hold food. So for me, this is my level of injury. I'm a little lower, but when I first started to have this pinch, I was able to independently feed myself. Once you're starting to get to this level, you can transfer yourself independently. And again, you can use a manual wheelchair inside and a power wheelchair outside. So you get to an option of either wheelchair, and the person this level can drive a modified van. As you get lower into the limb, you start to get more and more muscle function. You get your triceps. This allows you even more independence. This is a picture of me transferring into my car. This car was modified thanks to vocational rehabilitation when I was returning to work. So at this level of injury, you can use a manual wheelchair. That gives you greater independence. You're able to fold that chair up and put it in a car. You don't need a van for transportation. You don't need the, you know, something with an elevator or a ramp. You can just transfer into a car. I have options of driving a van or a car, but the car is sometimes an easier and cheaper modification. As you get lower, you get into thoracic spinal cord injury. These individuals have full function of their upper limbs, and they're independent. Most of their activities of daily living, they can transfer independently. They use a manual wheelchair, and they generally drive a modified car just because it's easier. And then as you get lower and lower, if you have a lower back level injury, you may actually be able to ambulate, whether it be in a gym or in the community. You're independent, most of your activities of daily living, you transfer independently and you use a manual wheelchair and you can drive a modified automobile. So it's all about getting more and more function back. And that's what we try to focus on. One of the things I want to talk about is the wheelchair. So many of you may hear the phrase, a person is bound by their wheelchair. I will say, for me, the wheelchair is probably one of the most important things that any physician can prescribe for a person with spinal cord injury, because that wheelchair allows them to get out of their bed and be independent inside and outside. So you aren't bound by your wheelchair. You're actually given freedom by your wheelchair. If I didn't have a wheelchair, then I'd be bound to my bed. And so one of the things I just want to kind of dispel is that term concept of wheelchair bound. And just to kind of emphasize that point, and also just people with spinal cord injury, if given the proper equipment and proper devices, just how independent they can be. I want to show you a video to just some gentlemen doing some pretty amazing things. So you'll see, I mean, this person's learning proper skills. This individual can tackle stairs on their own. So with their wheelchair, they're able to be independent and get out. Even if there isn't a ramp, even if there is an access, they're able to overcome obstacles because they have a proper wheelchair and proper training. So you just see the importance of the wheelchair and how much actually it gives them independence. So even if they didn't have an elevator or access to a ramp, they can figure out a way. Even do escalators. Because there isn't always an elevator that's easily available. So these are skills that we try to teach people at Kessler so that they can be even more independent. And again, you know, it's used learning how to use your wheelchair as an extension of your body. Okay. So I'm gonna end it early, but I just wanted to again show you just the role that assistive technology plays in helping people with spinal cord injury become independent. And with that, I'm going to pass on the next part of the presentation to my colleague, Dr. John O'Neill. John?
Hello, everybody. Thank you, Trevor. I'm going to briefly review resource facilitation in terms of what it is, who developed it, and et cetera. Essentially, resource facilitation is a employment intervention that was first developed at the Mayo Clinic. And its signature element is an intervention that starts during the inpatient medical rehabilitation stay and continues after discharge, and includes elements like work trials, providing community services and supports, temporary or long-term supported employment, and employer education. Jim Malik and his colleagues at the Mayo Clinic ran a series of studies using resource facilitation, and it was focused on people with acquired brain injuries. They observed that 40 to 50% of the folks who received resource facilitation had returned to work 1 year post injury, compared to a number of longitudinal studies that had been done in terms of return to work among this population that showed less than 30% return to work rate 1 year post injury. There were also a couple of randomized controlled trials, very small ones that were done in Indiana by staff that worked with Dr. Malik, and there were two small randomized controlled trials, one with 22 folks, another with 44 folks. And in the first trial, they found a 64% return to work rate after 1 year post injury for those who received vocational resource facilitation versus 36% for those who didn't. And in the larger study, which included 44 folks, they found a 60% return to work rate for folks who received resource facilitation, but only 50% return to work rate after 1 year. Next slide. And one of the reasons for vocational resource facilitation amongst people with SCI is that the employment rate after injury is quite low. It's only 12%. The most current data from the model systems indicates, from the SCI model systems, indicate that return to work rate is only 12% at 1 year post injury. And 28% at 10 years post injury. One of the challenges for current acute medical rehabilitation facilities is that the stays have become shorter and shorter. There were periods of time, I think, Trevor, you had mentioned that you were inpatient medical rehab for about 6 months. Now the stays can be as short as 3 or 4 weeks. And there was a time when state vocational rehabilitation agencies were engaged in and with folks who were inpatient rehabilitation. But as the stays got shorter and the focus was primarily on getting people functional and ready for home, most acute medical rehab facilities have reduced their utilization of state VR agencies. And also, you know, the state VR agencies over time have been expanding their client base, and a lot of attention has moved, not totally away, obviously, from the acute medical rehabilitation context, but with much of the focus now is on youth in transition. There's been an increased importance placed on folks with psychiatric disabilities and other and developmental disabilities. And so that gap between the acute medical rehab context and what state vocational rehabilitation agencies are primarily focusing on has widened. There's also very limited follow-up post-discharge in medical rehabilitation facilities. They just are not funded for the follow-up post-discharge. And so, you know, what the follow-up will be in the outpatient setting. So there is follow-up there, but again, there's not a lot of vocational rehabilitation engagement, even though there is some, but it's not as much as it might have been at one time. Next slide. So one of the goals of starting vocational resource facilitation at the Kessler Institute for Rehabilitation Medicine was to infuse inpatient vocational resource facilitation services, followed by systematic and assertive vocational resource facilitation 2 years post-discharge. That included creating peer networking employment groups, which we are a project back in June 2016 through September of this year. We have served 113 folks with SCI. And 57 of those individuals have returned to work with a return to work rate of about 50%. Next slide. Many people have wondered why early intervention? Isn't it too early to be intervening employment-wise, vocationally? After folks have been newly admitted to their acute medical rehabilitation facility, and our response is a resounding no. And the reasons are, if you start on the inpatient unit, you're reinforcing the fact that people can, with SCI, can work after their injury. Excuse my telephone ringing in the background. what's important about it is the early coordination with the clinical team on work-related goals. Discussions start while people are inpatients and continue to outpatient therapy. Clinicians want to help, but to work goals that individuals might have. As an employee of the hospital, the resource facilitator can coordinate services between the patient, the clinical team, and available hospital and community resources. This is an important element. Having someone from the outside drop in and help or assist with the transition from inpatient to outpatient voc rehab services is certainly an option, but it doesn't work as well as the resource facilitator actually being an employee of the hospital. Also, starting early, we're able to maintain connection to the employer to their employer if they were employed early in the process. And that's really important because employers, after someone is newly injured, are obviously going to be sympathetic and aware of what the person is up against. And oftentimes folks can return to their previous positions or even an alternate position with their former employer, and that work is maintains the connection to the workforce. So early intervention is critical. Next slide. Eligibility, folks that are eligible for vocational resource facilitation within KAR, those who are newly injured less than 1 year, and obviously inpatients between the ages of 18 and 64. With traumatic or non-traumatic SCI, they are obviously admitted to inpatient services at Kessler Institute, and they intend to live in northern New Jersey after discharge. And they have interest in pursuing employment or education that will lead to competitive employment and able to speak and understand English. Next slide. At this point, I'll hand it over to Adria, who will finish out the presentation with an in-depth view of how the whole vocational resource facilitation process works.
Thanks, Dr. O'Neill. So yes, we're going to review how the intervention is implemented. It's important to stress that I am a full-time employee of the hospital. Therefore, I'm an integrated member of the inpatient and outpatient spinal cord injury departments. What's also important to know is that each week, the doctors, the spinal cord injury doctors, host clinical team meetings. And this is where all members of the interdisciplinary team discuss patients' functional status and their updates and their progress towards their rehabilitation goals. We discuss barriers to community reintegration and independent living, as well as discharge planning. So because I'm a member, I'm a hospital employee and a member of these teams, I'm able to attend and join these meetings and be part of the clinical conversation. Because the therapy team has the most face time interacting with patients, they're often the first to learn about the patient's employment goals. So by attending the team meetings, it allows an opportunity for the clinical team to make referrals for vocational services. And then once I'm meeting with patients, I report back to the team during the meetings what goals we're establishing and even what coordination of other services I'm assisting with to help individuals with their transition to home. Being physically present within the clinical team meetings has also been very beneficial for many other reasons, but it's also led to a lot of co-treatments between myself and some of the therapists. So we allow for early introduction of assistive technology. So during my conversations with patients, I can explain to them some assistive technology that they might be able to use. And because we have access to it in our facility, I can then co-treat with the therapists and show them how they could use something like this. So we really start to change their thinking. Hopefully we're changing their thinking about themselves early on about what they can do within the workforce and how, like Dr. Dyson Hudson was explaining, how assistive technology leads to so much more independence for people, not just within their everyday lives, but also within a work setting. I meet with patients outside of their therapy schedule for individual vocational counseling. Here we really start to identify what the patient's work goal is. And I have a case example that we'll review in a second, but sometimes people are a bit overwhelmed about talking about work. They're thinking, it's hard for me to do X, Y, and Z, dress myself or feed myself. How am I supposed to work? But with these early intervention conversations, we're able to start to set the expectation that people can work and give examples and cite resources and services that are available to people that they can use to overcome some of the barriers or perceived barriers about returning to employment. Usually people have their goals to return to the same job, same employer. And the focus of the individual vocational counseling sessions is really to collect as much information as we can about that person's job. So oftentimes patients have their own verbal report and they give a lot of information about what their job entails, but also they have access to a job description I utilize ONET very often to go online and collect some industry information as well. But the intent of that is to guide the patient on going through every single essential job function and identifying perhaps what the potential barrier might be. It's kind of like an informal job analysis. And we look through each job description and we talk about it at length. Every task on the job description, we discuss at length. And the whole point is to identify the perceived barrier. Is there a physical barrier that might be able, that person might expect in order to complete that job function? And if so, what assistive technology and or accommodation might that person be able to use to overcome that particular job function? We might even start to discuss returning to work in a different position within the same employer. And the individuals are the best reported and they know the most information about where they could potentially move within their company or other positions that they can transition into, even if it's outside of their relationship with their current employer. So we really start to plant the seeds early on during these conversations. And as the person discharges from the hospital, that's when a lot of the quote unquote legwork happens, where we're planting seeds early, but then we have to continue to foster a relationship with partners in the community and also to coordinate services that will help them overcome these barriers as they progress within their rehabilitation. If patients are interested in learning about vocational rehabilitation services within the community, they're always receiving information about the New Jersey Division of Vocational Rehabilitation. So a lot of education about DVR services, eligibility process, the type of services that people have used and benefited from DVR is presented to our patients early on. And if individuals are interested in being referred for DVR services, I'm in the unique situation where I can pull together all of the referral paperwork and submit a referral to their local office. The goal is to schedule an intake meeting with patients and the DVR counselor, either in person or virtually before they discharge the hospital. And the benefits of this are many. First, we help to establish a social glue and a network of providers, services, and planning that the person is connected to before they leave the hospital. We instill a sense of hope that once they go home, they're not staying home, that they are most certainly able to engage in pre-injury activities, and one of them is employment. And the fact that we're talking about work makes it an expectation that they certainly can return to work. It's a long-term goal, presented as a long-term goal, but we have to break that long-term goal down into many different components of service planning and coordination to make that long-term goal become a reality. Next slide, please. So once a person discharges from our facility, the idea is to prevent them from straying from any of the initial planning or recommendations that we established during their inpatient stay. Individuals are eligible for 2 years of follow-along services, regardless of where they discharge to within Northern New Jersey. We utilize a person-centered approach to meet patients where they are by listening to them and supporting their goals and their needs, especially as they progress through their outpatient treatment, because their goals might change, their physical abilities might change. So constantly maintaining communication with them is important because we have to adjust our planning accordingly. We closely coordinate with the New Jersey Division of Vocational Rehabilitation, and we include family members throughout all aspects of the return to work planning process. Families kind of like our unsung heroes oftentimes, the caregivers, because they do so much, especially with the case example you'll see in a bit, this individual's role to completely change her work schedule in order to provide transport to the individual to get to and from work. So what we're doing is facilitating a smooth transition from medical to community-based services, with one of the primary focus being on return to work and return to education. Next slide, please. Okay, so here we we use a bar graph with three different benchmarks to illustrate our data comparison to see the impact of vocational resource facilitation. So I will briefly break down and describe this graph here. Our program outcomes is represented to the far right column in the royal navy blue color. So our program has a 44% employment rate at 1 year post-discharge for people with traumatic spinal cord injury. We compare our data to the spinal cord injury model system employment outcomes. And this was what Dr. Dyson Hudson was referring to earlier. So within the spinal cord injury model systems, there's information collected from people from patients who are enrolled within the system of care at different time frames and different intervals. Luckily, the spinal cord injury model systems collects for employment outcomes at 1 year post injury. So we compare our 44% to the far left over there. We have the spinal cord injury model system centers for all centers across all years. And there's about a 12% employment rate for people with traumatic spinal cord injury at 1 year post injury. When compared to our 44%, we have a 267 improvement over that particular benchmark. Next, in effort to control for the economy, we compare our outcomes to spinal cord injury model systems data again, but during the years of 2011 to 2016, which is shown in gray. So this time period reflects when we were coming out of the Great Recession, as well as the employment data collected right before our project began, which was in 2016. So we wanted to know right during before our program became about, what was the employment rate for the spinal cord injury model systems data between 2011 and 2016. They report a 16% employment rate for people with traumatic spinal cord injury. And when we compare that to our 44%, we have a 175% improvement over that benchmark. Finally, we control for geography. So Kessler is located in Northern New Jersey. So we compare our outcomes to the Northern New Jersey spinal cord system, which reports a 21% employment rate at 1 year post-discharge between the same time periods of 2011 and 2016, represented here in light blue. And when we compare that to our 44%, we have a 110% improvement over that benchmark. Next slide, please. Okay. So here we were interested in knowing of all the clients that have returned to work during their two-year enrollment, how many of them are returning to work within 1 year? So earlier, Dr. O'Neill indicated, and it's represented here on this table on the left, that since the program has been up and running, we've had 114 individuals with employment goals recruited into our program. And we have, as of October 31st, a 50-50 return to work rate. So 50% of our enrollees return to work. But we really wanted to focus on those 57 individuals. And we wanted to break that down further and see, well, how fast are they returning to work? So our table represented on the right, we break this down into three different categories. For all of our patients with spinal cord injury, we had 48 of the 57 return to work within 1 year. That gives us an 84% rate of individuals, all of our clients combined, returning to work within that time frame. We then break that down further into non-traumatic and traumatic spinal cord injury. So of the 57 people who returned to work, 17 of them had a non-traumatic spinal cord injury, and 15 out of 17 of them returned to work within 1 year, which is an 88% return to work rate within that time period. For our traumatic folks, there's 40 of them, 33 of the 40 return to work within 1 year, which is just about 83% for traumatic spinal cord injury. So if you're wondering why is this important, it confirms what we're doing. It tells us that the early intervention approach and the supportive, consistent follow-along services with collaboration with our partnership with the New Jersey Division of Vocational Rehabilitation, has a positive influence on increasing the employment outcomes and rate at which people with spinal cord injury are returning to work. Next slide, please. I mentioned earlier that the spinal cord injury model system collects information at different intervals, one of them being employment. And unfortunately, there's no collection of data on return to education status post spinal cord injury. So we collect separate statistics for clients who have goals to return to education. Kessler is an adult facility that can accept patients 16 years of age or older. But for this reason, the majority of our patients are of working age. Therefore, we have a much smaller group of individuals with goals to return to education. Since the program has been up and running since 2016, we've had 22 clients with goals to return to education. 14 of them have returned to education, which gives us a 64% return to work rate. When we break this down into traumatic and non-traumatic, it's 33% return to education, and 75% return to education rate, seen respectfully here. Next slide, please. One of the many, there's been many positive outcomes that the Kessler and DVR collaboration has provided and for our folks with spinal cord injury. And one of the most important pieces of information that we were able to uncover is what types of services are useful for people with spinal cord injury. So our combined partnership has developed a framework and a standard of care that illustrate best practices within vocational rehabilitation that are proving to be successful for increasing employment outcomes for people with spinal cord injury. So here we have listed the services that our clients who were eligible for DVR received and that were important to their ability to return to work and to return to education. The first four are the most commonly documented services, and this includes counseling and guidance, assistive technology evaluation and purchase of a recommended assistive technology, driver evaluation and training, and vehicle modification and adaptations. We've also had clients come through our program who received supported employment, job coach, job development services. Resident and job site modifications have been provided for our clients, continued physical, occupational, speech, or cognitive therapy through restoration services, travel reimbursement for some folks who had limited funds and resources to get to and from therapy and or work, vocational evaluations for our clients who were interested in seeking new types of employment pathways, medical equipment devices, so purchasing of different components of a wheelchair that one might need at work, or a brace in order to help with their ambulation and maintain completion of their work functions during the day, as well as tuition sponsorship for our folks who have goals of returning back to education, certification, or some type of retraining that will lead to new employment. Next slide, please. So Kessler serves clients from all over the country. However, as mentioned earlier, our program only serves the 13 counties seen here on this list. So we thought it would be helpful just to develop some type of pie chart to show where our clients who are receiving vocational resource facilitation services are living within the different counties on this list. So the majority of our clients are living in Essex County, and makes sense. We're located in Essex County, but 26% of our total population is residing there, followed by Bergen County, which is 21% of our total population, and then followed by Union County, which is 15%. We've never served anybody from Hunterdon County, and we just added Monmouth and Ocean County. And so Monmouth, we haven't had anybody enrolled in our program from that area yet as well. Next slide. So we are going to present a case example about Mr. G. And Mr. G is, at the time of his injury, he was 53 years old, a C5 Asia impairment level C, which is an incomplete tetraplegia. And he was with his wife and his son in a park at his son's baseball game, and a big storm came up by. So he was walking with his wife and his daughter and his son to the car, and they were parked under a bunch of trees, and the tree branch fell and struck him on the head, and that's how he sustained his spinal cord injury. He was employed for 16 years as a warehouse associate for a furniture company. And his initial goal was to return to work in the same or different role with his same employer. Next slide, please. So how we have this broken down, we wanted to represent the case example a bit differently. We wanted to illustrate the frequency and the type of services that our clients can receive through vocational resource facilitation. So we created a timeline that shows the type of services that our clients can receive during the inpatient early intervention phase, which is this particular slide here, but also followed by the outpatient services, the 2-year follow-along period that individuals are eligible for, that all lead to competitive employment. So for the interest of time, I'm not going to go through each and every service and event on this timeline here. Although you can read along, I will just discuss some of the most important services and events and milestones that this individual achieved through the service coordination. So the individual was sustained his injury in July, came to Kessler in August, and was enrolled in the Vocational Resource Facilitation Program by late August. The individual worked for a furniture company in a warehouse for 16 years, so his job was incredibly physical in nature, requiring him to lift, move, and on occasion assemble furniture. He also used warehouse equipment such as a forklift and a handheld pallet to move around furniture throughout the day. So when presenting him with the idea of returning to work, Mr. G was very motivated and interested, but also apprehensive because his occupation is so physical. As you can see within this timeline, he was given a lot of information and education initially about potential pathways for returning to work with or without accommodations. So this includes extensive information about the definition of an accommodation, what is considered an accommodation, and how does one determine if an accommodation is reasonable based off of his particular job. At the inpatient level, he received information about state and federal disability benefits that included how to apply for them and using applicable work incentives once he does return back to work to support that initial transition back to work without fear of losing his benefits and or if he's unsuccessful trying to transition back to work for the first time. So I sat with him and his wife for many hours collecting paperwork and documentation that they needed to submit in order to complete an online application for Social Security disability. When discussing community reintegration and preparing him for discharge home, he was provided assistance to apply for accessible community transportation through Access Link, but also through his county transportation. Mr. G is a power wheelchair user, so his home was not accessible. And our goal always here as a team is to support a discharge home and a discharge to the community. So with the county he resides in, I'm aware that there's their Center for Independent Living has a ramping program for individuals who need assistance to pay for and install ramps to enter and exit their home. Mr. G was a really strong candidate for that. And I have built partnerships with this particular Center for Independent Living over the years. And when explaining the story and explaining the potential trajectory of returning back to work, as well as other community reintegration goals that this person has had, the company actually exceeded their budget quite a bit and paid a little bit more than what was typically allotted for clients, just so that he could have the appropriate and safe type of ramp to get in and out of his home. So that's just another really good example of integrating vocational. You might think, how is that helpful for a person to work? Well, if a person can't get in and out of their home, how might they be able to go to work? But also from the medical team, it's supporting the goals of the of the doctors and the rehab team to support a transition back to the community, and they were not aware of this particular resource. So that ability to be present and aware of what the barriers are from a discharge home standpoint, and within my role was able to help coordinate that service for him as well. You can see that my first communication with his employer was in September. So less than a month after he was enrolled into the program, he gave permission for me to communicate with his employer. So early on, we're able to engage communication and build relationships with people's employers with permission, of course, from the client and when medically appropriate. But given this person's work history within this company for so long, 16 years, he was very comfortable with my reaching out to the employer and introducing myself and explaining that we'd like to, in the future, continue to have conversations about a return to work plan once medically stable. Having these conversations early on is so helpful, I've found, especially because you can see here that it's not just one person that I'm talking to. I'm not just talking to their particular boss or their superior. It's learning about what disability-related policies that person has access to and is available within their company. So I ended up speaking to many different people within this individual's line of work. One person in particular was at their long-term disability company who oversees that policy. And they were more than happy to send me a copy of the policy. And I'm reading through this very lengthy, complicated policy. And I find that the company offers a vocational rehab benefit. And essentially they offer a budget for worksite modifications to support people to return back to work. So my client had no idea that this existed. I'm not sure if the employer would have known that that's something he could ask or use upon his return to work planning. But knowing that this exists, to me, is telling in a couple of ways. It tells me that, okay, this company is pretty progressive. They definitely want to retain valuable employees. They have a vocational component within their long-term disability. They want to bring people back to the workforce. But two, how can I leverage the information in this policy to help pay for some things that we don't know we might need this early on, but can kind of anticipate he'll need some adjustments made to his work site within the future? Next slide, please. Here we see the remaining slides for this individual. They're all showing the outpatient follow-along services that for the two-year period that he was discharged from our program. So once he left the hospital, there was still regular conversation with him and his wife and involvement and communication with his employer. And if you can just see on the way that this is broken down, there's many different instances of employer services, who I'm talking to throughout his time during his rehabilitation. So I'm speaking to, they have something called a wellness manager who is kind of like HR, but not HR. And this person basically was, I would say, their point person for all disability related types of policies and legislation that they want to support and implement within their company. And then there's also individuals I collaborated with, the warehouse manager. So the warehouse manager, was helpful for our conversations because they gave me a functional job description. So I had not only just the job description, but the functional job description, which explains all of the physical requirements of the job with really great pictures about different types of equipment that he has to use within working in the warehouse. It became pretty obvious and something that my client had to accept that he was not physically able to go back to that same position of working in the warehouse due to his physical impairments. And it's not safe. We could discuss accommodations all day, but if safety is an issue, then it's not something that we support or will try to facilitate, even if accommodations are available to him. So we started to talk with the employer about, well, what other positions can he potentially transition into? And if you see here, we have customized employment in 127. So the employer said, you know, we could use him in a customer service role, but we have so many issues that come up at our work that are related to the warehouse. So we could basically develop a new role, or he'll be in a customer service role with modified duties in order to address all the warehouse related issues. And he's the perfect candidate for that because he's worked in the warehouse. So not only does he know the system and the operation and how the warehouse functions, but he knows the people and the communication and how the two separate departments need to collaborate in order to rectify a lot of these customer service related issues. So here I am, like, fireworks are going off. This is great. You know, the employer will be incredibly happy because they'll be able to fix this this issue, but it also allows Mr. Green an opportunity to utilize his pre-existing knowledge and skills and experience at the warehouse and apply it into a new position. Mr. G wanted to wait until February to submit a referral to GVR. So it wasn't until mid-February that that referral was initially submitted. Next slide, please. Once we established an intake meeting with DVR and his eligibility and case was open, we were able to really justify and explain to DVR what we expect this person might need in order to get him back to work. We've already identified that the employer is involved and they're collaborative and they want to work with us. We've identified that there's a opportunity for transitioning to work in a new position. And what does that position entail? But from a physical standpoint and my experience in working with people with spinal cord injury, we anticipate that there would be some physical barriers to complete the essential job functions of a customer support associate. So I had to start to collect documentation about what potential barriers this person would encounter. So if you can see between March through basically June, I met with him weekly and we were doing work simulation. So not only did I create a task that required him to go onto his company website and find all this information about furniture and enter it into an Excel sheet, but I collaborated with our cognitive rehab program, the therapist there, who had patients who needed to work on their return to work skills as well. So we co-treated together across different departments, and my client had to respond to incoming calls and rectify information that was incorrect and recommunicate that information to a third person. So we really were trying to simulate as much as possible without knowing all the details of his job, but it gave enough observation to anticipate that he's making typing errors, or he's slow, or he can't manage a phone and typing on the computer and using a traditional mouse the way someone else. Like, it just gave a really good quick snapshot about some larger problems that he might be having across a work day within a more competitive setting. DVR also asked us to provide a letter of intent from the employer, indicating that we are hoping to bring back this person in this type of role. And because I had that relationship with the former employer, positive relationship, and we've been in communication for many months, that was an easy request to ask the employer to provide that type of letter of intent. The hope that you're seeing through this case example is that so much is being done before we bring our clients to DVR to kind of identify information, identify barriers, and hopefully offer some collaborative recommendations and solutions and planning that we can share with DVR to continue the pathway towards employment. When DVR gave permission and agreed with the recommendation to do a worksite evaluation, I then had to go back to the employer and explain to them what this is. So not only was the employer educated about DVR role and how not information about the agency, but their role within this client's case, they were open to having this this assistive technology evaluation occur on site. So we had to kind of be the intermediary between the employer, DVR, my client, in order to explain the service and ask for permission for it to occur on site. Next slide, please. We completed the assistive technology evaluation late in August, but beforehand, as we're planning for it, we're talking about other options that are that the employer provides that would allow the client to return to work. So this was working from home within a customer support role or working in person, and then discussing with my client what are the pros and cons and potential barriers of having either of those two work positions available to you. The reason why the remote customer support associate role was not preferred by my client is because he thrives off of the interpersonal interaction and being around his peers at work. He was very concerned about productivity and staying at home when he knows if I can just get to work, I'll be able to be more productive. I'll feel like myself, I'll be with my colleagues. The other component is he'd have to be bringing equipment to and from work, which would get a little bit complicated. So having all of his equipment within one area was really the on site was the preferred way for him to return to work in person. That was his goal. Aside from this, there was some adjustment issues that my client was experiencing. So as having the consistent relationship with clients and regular communication, I get to know them very well. And having background in counseling, I'm able to help to identify some other adjustment related issues and concerns that people are encountering. So we've worked very closely with him to search within his health insurance network to identify a mental health provider and kind of take that to the next step of you've been so positive this whole time, you've overcome so much, but you're still feeling that there's an adjustment piece that you haven't really been addressing. So connecting people to other services, not just vocational services, is part of the resource facilitation because we're able to have this holistic approach, person-centered approach, to really connect them to all of the services that will make them their best selves. Being a power wheelchair user, we then dove into this realm of transportation to and from work. And this has been quite the back and forth. But what we've decided on, we've explored Access Link, we explored the county transport. He can transfer into his wife's car. So the plan that we have identified is him taking Access Link to work one day a week, and then his wife will pick him up and take him home for the remaining 3 days of the week. But he'll be leaving his power wheelchair at work. And we had to get clearance and recommendation and involvement from his physical therapist to see, is this safe for him? So this client has made fantastic goals within his rehabilitation. He's able to ambulate short distances with a rolling walker. But we needed to know for household ambulation, which is where he would be without the power wheelchair, was this safe for him? And the PT gave her blessing and said, yes, that's absolutely appropriate. But for work, over an 8-hour workday, we were preferring and recommending that he remain using his power wheelchair so that he, well, first of all, it's scripted to his body. So for comfort reasons, this would be a really a desirable type of device for him to use, but also for him to perform weight shifts throughout the day. We also want to ensure the maximum safety for him. So having the power wheelchair does just give that a little bit more level of protection and safety as opposed to him using his rolling walker. So the type of wheelchair he'll be using at work depends on his transportation. So having permission from the employer to leave the power wheelchair at work in a safe area really was important to help facilitate and overcome the transportation component that was presenting as a pretty large barrier for him to return to work. Next slide, please. Okay, so here you can see there's a lot of continued information about speaking with his employer about the recommendations that were outlined in the assistive technology evaluation. DVR has been fantastic in purchasing the recommended items for this person, and his employer is in the process of installing door openers within the facility for him to be able to fairly access and safely access different components of the facility. Our focus now is on tightening everything up, kind of finalizing his work schedule based off of his therapy schedule and availability of his wife to transport him to and from work. We started to talk about individualized work incentive counseling. So he's a recipient of SSDI. We're talking about the trial work period. We're talking about extended period of eligibility. We're talking about New Jersey buy-in workability program. So I'm showing him all these different benefits he can use to support his transition back to work. And he's really excited by it. He's actually thinks Social Security is very nice in terms of what they offer for people with going back to work. Knowing that there's a job offer, knowing when there's an anticipated start date can help us gauge at what point do we need to start these conversations and initiate the individualized benefits counseling. I'm happy to say that last week he had a virtual interview and received a verbal offer to return back to work. So we are just waiting for the finalized door openers to be installed and for purchasing of some recommended assistive technology through DVR sponsorship, and then hopefully a start date within the next couple of weeks. So it's a lot of different services that are being coordinated. We are not pushing work. We see opportunities and we address them and we use them and we figure out how to creatively problem solve different barriers. And I think what's so wonderful about this case is the employer involvement and the importance of the resource facilitator to facilitate a collaborative relationship with important people within the workforce to get people back to their previous position. So we're close to running out of time. I'll stop there and take it over for question and answer at this point.
We'd like to open it up if anyone has any questions they'd like to ask of the team, specific to the resource facilitation or to spinal cord injury.
Please don't be shy. The presentation also has our email address. So if it's something that occurs to you later or you want to ask more personally, please feel free to email any of us on the team.
And I believe I'll have the ability to email those who signed up the PowerPoint as well as some resource information. Just to note, this will be uploaded eventually to inform our internal system along with the video of this presentation and additional resources.
Would it be helpful, John, for us to provide a PDF version of the PowerPoint presentation for you to share?
Sure, I thought I might have. Oh, PDF. Sure.
PDF, just something simple that's not as big. If people just want the slides as kind of visuals, notes, I can do an arrangement where there are lines next to each slide if people like to kind of jot notes down.
I believe there are a question that came in. It says, how do you work with families that have difficulty accepting the new life for the family after spinal cord injury?
Happy to start answering that one. We have a program here called Caregiver Corner, and it's run by her new title is nurse transition coordinator. And we've identified that caregivers, like I mentioned earlier, they're the unsung heroes of really doing so much and providing so much for our patients, and that they need support. So we have, I think it's once a month, a group called Caregiver Corner, and it's run by two seasoned staff members here who've been, one's a case manager by trade and the other one is an OT by trade. And they really sit and they create this great group with other caregivers to kind of hear all of their questions and concerns. They're able to communicate that with the team, but sometimes it's just not always addressed in the way that it needs to be addressed through a more individualized group. So we have that, but oftentimes, you know, what I like to do is to connect our patients with other individuals who've achieved similar goals that have gone through our program. So let's say they have a similar level of injury and they used to work in manual and physical labor, let's say construction, connecting them, the patient, to another peer who's successfully returned back to work, and then their family members, creates a beautiful network for them to get just insider information and insight that I can't provide that. I don't have a spinal cord injury. I don't know what it's like to be in that particular role. So hearing it from an individual who's lived it and that has the support of their family is so impactful and meaningful to kind of support the family members and the individuals who are very much involved in their care.
And I would just add that to continue ongoing services, I mean, it's an iterative process. It takes time. It's a lot for people. I was in the medical field. I was in medical school when my injury happened. And I was completely overwhelmed. You know, I felt so alone. My whole life was turned upside down. Same with the family. And it's not something it takes time and starts in the hospital and transitions out into the community.
There's another question. Have there been any recent developments in the field of stem cell research and CRISPR that could lead to breakthroughs in spinal cord injury repair?
Sure. So, you know, I mean, stem cells are such a hot topic, and they're doing a lot of great research in that area. And we continue to be optimistic. There's small breakthroughs. I think one of the areas where we've seen a lot of breakthroughs are in the area of technology. So using maybe devices in combination with rehabilitation. So you'll hear about spinal stimulation. So there are these nerve stimulators that are often used for pain to try to treat chronic pain in people. And what they've found is that using these stimulators, you may actually be able to bypass certain pathways. So doing this in combination with intense therapy, they're starting to see some pretty impressive changes. I don't think there's going to be one single thing. I don't think there's a magic bullet. I think it'll be a combination of things and, you know, assistive technology. I think ultimately, I joke with people, work is the cure for spinal cord injury, because if you are, gainfully employed, right? Social Security considers you to no longer be disabled. So, you know, once you're independent and working, Social Security says, well, you're no longer disabled. So there's the cure. But no, I think joking aside, I think, you know, getting people back out into the community, back on with their lives, work is so important to all of us. Families, having families, doing things, sports, recreation, you know, and then the other things will come along. So.
Well, I just, again, want to thank everyone for sharing a wonderful presentation and a very in-depth, thorough examination of spinal cord injury, as well as the vocational resource facilitation. Have a great day, everyone, and thank you again. Take care.
Thanks, John, and thank you for organizing, John. Thanks, everyone, for attending.